Hello, and welcome to Rowan University. Please take a moment to locate the fire exit nearest your seat and aisle. In an emergency, please exit quickly and quietly. Regarding this event, please note the following. Smoking is not permitted in the auditorium or throughout the building. Please disable all cell phones, beepers, or other electronic devices. Food and beverages are not permitted. The use of cameras and recording equipment is strictly prohibited in the auditorium. Thank you for your cooperation. Enjoy the program.
Dean joined us in 1979. He was only the second professor of recreation. During his 39 years tenure here at Rochester State and now Rowan, he commissioned and premiered over 50 new works for percussion, and 32 of his percussion students won the Rowan University Orchestra's annual chair competition. As a performer, Dean played percussion in the San Antonio Symphony from 1973 to 79, and was also a member of the Rochester Philharmonic Orchestra and the opera companies of Philadelphia and Boston. He also performed all over the world with an extensive list of celebrities, including Sammy Davis Jr., Dean Martin, Rosemary Clooney, Johnny Mathis, and Tony Bennett, as well as the house bands of Claire, Resorts, Casinos, and Atlantic City. Professor Witten toured the world as a member of the Frank Sinatra Orchestra for 8 years, and also performed in the Count Basie Orchestra and the Buddy Rich Band and the Mel Lewis Jazz Orchestra. And if you didn't see it on the way in, there is a display case in the lobby with a lot of memorabilia for Dean's life. A piece that I think is really interesting is his part from New York, New York, when he played. He held a Master of Music degree from Trinity University, Bachelor of Music degree and Performer Certificate from the Eastman School of Music, and he was a proud alum of the Boston Latin School. Today, this concert will celebrate and illustrate a fact that we already know to be true, and that is that Dean's work as a musician and as an educator will continue to resonate for many decades to come. And it's particularly pleasing, I think he'd be proud to have so many of his alums back here to perform today. Through our celebration today, we are also pursuing two lasting ways to honor Dean well into the future. The first is this concert marks, with the support of a generous donor, the official dedication of the room that we've always known as Dean's Studio, as the Dean Witten Percussion Studio. And I invite you after the concert to come see the plaque that now hangs outside this door that will communicate these works to many future generations of Rowan musicians. And additionally, this concert serves as a fundraiser for the Dean Witten Percussion Scholarship Fund. All of the proceeds from today will move us forward toward our goal of endowing this fund, so we will give percussion scholarships in perpetuity while transforming the lives of future Rowan percussionists, just as Dean did for so many students. So I'm smiling as I look at the Red Sox cap over here. I miss stopping by Dean's studio to hear his take on how the Red Sox are having a really great year. He's still just a little bit worried about them, but it's his ego that he's here and smiling at this. So again, welcome. I just wanted to introduce the next couple of pieces that are going to be played by the percussion ensemble. A little bit out of order, but next we'll be the Levitt Tambourine Quartet. And all of the pieces that we chose for the program tonight are pieces that my father championed, pieces that he loved, pieces that represent stylistic errors that he was very much an enthusiast of. All of these things are things that everyone here who came back today worked on during their time in Rome with my father. The Levitan, when you open up the score, has the date from every time they played it, and this is like the eighth group that's played it. Over 38 years, that's a lot of times playing the same piece, playing that piece that many times. So I think that shows you how much you like that piece. I think you'll also hear for yourselves what a great piece it is. So I wasn't going to tell you too much about the piece other than that. That's the reason why we're doing it. And then that's in a few more pieces we're going to be playing you the iconic benchmark of a contemporary music piece and one of the first and most important percussion ensemble pieces ever. Very well-known famous piece. Every percussionist knows this piece. It's Brez's Ionization. And it's, other than its significance that my father must have done that maybe 10 times in the 38 years that he was here, and everybody does it. It's maybe one of, if not the most important percussion ensemble piece. So that's why we're playing that one. And I think when the Levitan kids come up and play their quartet, I think you'll see why I love that piece, why my father loved that piece. The students love the piece. They actually told me they wanted to play it. And so that's why we're doing our piece, is for all of our love for this. It's a beautiful piece. And I think without further ado, I'd like to bring up the president of our university and let him talk to you.
My son was a student here from 2007 to 2011. He was studying biology in Georgetown. And also he, from childhood, he liked drum, playing drums, and Witten basically. He was there again. And basically self-taught himself. He never kind of did any classic training or anything like that. When he came here, he was doing these things. And one day he just told me, mentioned to me in passing that, I'm sometimes going to Lee Witten's place or studio and play some drums. I can be loud and all of the things. So that's what I knew, and I didn't know anything more than that. And last week my wife was talking to him on the phone and she had a speaker. When we were talking, I said to him, by the way, Pastor, and next week I'm going to the memorial concert for Lee Witten past recently. Do you remember him? And he said, yes. And then he went quiet. And everything was quiet, and my wife would listen to him, and then we started hearing him weeping. Witten sent me a text that I wanted to read to you. And then he sent me another text that I'm not going to read to you because there's some curse words in there. So it says, sorry, I'm shaking a little bit, so I just can't read this properly. He was a really nice writer. He understood that I was a self-taught drummer and knew that he needed to teach me differently. He wasn't classically trained, but he was able to help me develop as a percussionist. Meeting with him weekly was awesome. One-on-one time where he helped me build exactly what I wanted. He was helping me as a professor, but treating me like a friend. I think this story tells how he felt about his kids. I was insanely loud behind the drums, a born-on type. I was soloing one day for him, and the teacher angrily walked and rose. We can't hear you. You can't hear our class over here. Can you please tone it down? Embarrassed, I was ready to oblige. Dean's response, yeah, I can do that. I have a lesson doing here. So his last word, rock on in heaven with the greatest. And then, subsequent to that, he sent me a bunch of texts telling me how angry he was at me that he should have gone past the marsh. And I didn't tell him, I said, I'm sorry that you didn't know the depth of your relationship. But here is an example of what I call a modern teacher. He had absolutely no reason to trust him. I didn't know about him. Nobody mentioned him to me. He wasn't doing me a favor. I didn't ask him to review. And he was a kid who was in a completely different major, and he was doing that, and that was the record. And you can see sometimes as teachers and educators,
Thank you.
I'm Bob Rowan's chair of the music department. Some individuals have personalities that seem larger than life. Dean was such an individual. Our next performer, Adeline Tonson, is such an individual. When personalities like that come together, that's a lot of energy. When personalities clash, results can be unpredictable. But personalities click, results can be magical. Adeline likes to tell the story of her first meeting with Dean. He said to her, "Do you wear lipstick when you play?" And without missing a beat, she said, "Why, do you?" And from that moment, their relationship clicked and they worked together splendidly ever since. To tell you more about the composition, she's going to perform Dr. Adeline Tonson.
Thank you. Good afternoon. I'm supposed to buy a little time as the podium, as the pitch kind of raises. It was interesting to me that Dr. Hushman spoke about the modern teacher, and I think Dean exemplified that in a number of ways. One that I'll point out really quickly is he always put his students first. If we were to walk by his studio on any given day, there'd be always a posting about what students are doing. Did they win a competition? Did they get into the military? Of course, when you would go inside the room, you'd be humbled by all the posters and things like that that Dean had done. But before you came in, he always wanted the students to know that they were what he put first. I see I have about another 5 feet. I'm just going to really quickly say, Dean Witten spent 30 years making most of his college try harder. Be it in musicianship or family life or running, he always managed to do everything at the best. I'll just tell you two things really quickly. Dean and I were runners, and we used to always talk about running races and things like that. He did the Marine Corps Marathon and the LA Marathon. But for most of our career running, I would usually get the better of Dean. And he had the last laugh on me because the last time we ran the Philadelphia Distance Run, I didn't have a good day. And as we approached the Falls Bridge, which is around the 8 mile mark, I sort of started to slow down and Dean sped up and kept running. Of course, he beat me badly that day. And it sort of crushed me because I had sort of owned him before that. Dean waited 10 years before he told me that he felt so good that day beating me, but he knew that that day would not have been the day to tell me that he beat me. So here we're going to hear this iconic piece of ionization. I'll just add one more piece of this. I wasn't what I would call a knowledgeable student about modern music when I was coming up. But when I was in college, I had a friend who was into Frank Zappa's music. And apparently this work is one of the works that Frank Zappa heard early in his career that kind of led him down the path of creating the novel music that he created. So thank you so much for being here and enjoy the rest of the concert.
There was such a wide range of personalities across the board in the percussion studio, and obviously that changes every semester too. And you have this unique group of people that's always changing, but Dean always seemed to know exactly the right buttons to push with each person to motivate every single person in the studio despite how different we all were. And I think his ability to motivate everyone, to make everyone work their absolute hardest, is really remarkable, a great teacher.
Hi, I'm Rachel Wansky. I'm in 11th grade, and I had Dean for teaching for 2 years. Dean and I were very close, and I really did love him. I'll always remember at one of our lessons, I wasn't playing loud enough, and he reached over and felt my bicep. When I was finished, he said, I was looking for some muscles, but I couldn't find any. You've got some spaghetti arms, girl. And after that, spaghetti arms became my nickname with just about everyone. Dean was the best teacher I've ever had, and there isn't a day where I don't miss him.
Okay. When I'm finished rehearsing the jazz band, I would walk by Dean's office, and if he was in there, I would just open the door and walk in. Sometimes if he was talking to a student and he saw me, he would just wave me in. But I would sit in this black wooden chair. He had this wooden black chair. It was so comfortable every time I sat down. I said, Dean on his chair. It's great, man. His chair is great. Well, he can't have it with mine. Not when I graduated. So we talk about his chair. And it doesn't matter what we're talking about. We like to talk, and everybody, we were all animated. It was great. Dean would get excited about anything. We talked about Alice, Matt, my brother Natalie, the music business, playing, integrity, teaching, politics. We would talk about everything. Dean, he just loved it. It was great. And if you love something, you're passionate, and his passion just helped everything spin out of control. So it was great. So I was reading this book by Daniel McCullough called The Great Bridge, and it's a history of the Brooklyn Bridge. And I'm telling Dino all about it, and Dino says, well, we should go up. I spent a lot of time in New York playing gigs, but I never go anywhere. I don't go see the Empire State Building or the Circle Line Cruise or anything. He just go in and out. So we say, yeah, let's go. So we make a plan, and we go up, and we walk the Brooklyn Bridge. And the whole time I'm telling him about what I read in the book and how this happened and that happened. And Dino says, look, let's go to St. Andrew's Scotch Bar. It's a bar in New York that has just scotch. And we have to. So we go, and it's great. We walk in, and they're all dressed up in the garb, you know. And we sit at the bar, and the bartender comes up. A woman comes up and says, what would you guys like? Tell me what you're into, and we'll see what we have. You know, and Dean says, we'd like to do a tasting. Could you give us a scotch tasting? And she goes, you'd like a tasting, would you not? I'll start you off with a Deanston. Deanston's a good single one. She goes, a Deanston's a good smooth one to get started with. In fact, it's as smooth as a baby's ass. And as soon as she said that, Dino said, this is perfect. This is the exact place you want to be. So we have a great time doing this scotch tasting. And Dean is having a ball, and they're just hanging. It's great. They're just hanging out. And maybe we're there for 2-3 hours. We wound up driving home, and we were listening to Sinatra the whole time down the shore here. And we had a great time, and it was a great time with people. We talked about Sinatra, we just listened to everything and talked. And it would, the talks that I had with them, 3-4 times a week, where that was the real cement for me, that when I think about it, I think about it, that I just default to those times, and we would just talk about everything. You know, it was an open book. Yeah, if you look at what Jive is, Dean is the opposite. Whatever Jive is, he's the opposite. There was no jiving around like Dean. I miss him. And the day it goes by, I'll think about it. But anyway, here's the photo. Here's Brooklyn Bridge. Here we are. On the Brooklyn Bridge.
Hi, I'm AJ Lasek-Bianchi, and I just wanted to take a moment to reflect on Dean's influence in my life. He was a gentleman, a consummate professional, and fantastic musician in person. And I just wouldn't be where I am today, and the person who I am without his profound influence in, on my life. I couldn't thank him enough. There aren't any words to describe any of that. And the world is missing a great, great person. I miss him.
Dean's lessons often extended beyond concussion. Coming out of the Reagan Bush years, Dean was the first role model to tell me it's okay to be a liberal. It's okay to be the man that you want to be the man that you have to be. For me, that was monumental and life-altering. From then on, I set out to find my own voice musically and politically.
Everybody attending this event knows very well that Dean was an advocate for teaching the whole student or the whole person and not just percussion. He would try to teach us all about life or whatever career path we were going down through the medium of percussion. Everybody in this room probably knows, you know, his saying, everything is everything, and everything really is everything. One thing that stuck out to me as being a female student of his is that I think he did a terrific job of empowering women and female students in not just percussion or conducting, but also just in the music industry overall. I always felt supported by him, and he taught us as females that we will have to face adversity in the workforce, unfortunately. And he gave us some tools on how to deal with that, and that was really cool for me to hear. You know, when I was 16 years old, I thought that was pretty cool. I'll never forget that when he was talking to me about whether I wanted to be a performance major or a music ed major, I didn't want to be a music ed major, but he encouraged me to just do it anyway, just in case I wanted to fall back on teaching, but now that's all I do. And I actually fall back on playing. And he always talked about teachers should actually take the oath that doctors have to take, which is do no harm to the patient. And so in this case, it's do no harm to the student. And that as a teacher, you always have to do the absolute best thing for your students 100% of the time and make sure that you advocate for them as people and humans and not just whatever it might be, a number or someone producing music. So that was really important for me. Dean essentially was my father. He taught me, he molded me into the person I am today. He taught me to be on time, he taught me to be prepared. He taught me how to navigate adversity in the workplace. He taught me how to speak to people. I mean, actually how to dress well, you know, how to look professional, please and thank you. I remember one time, I didn't even know I rolled my eyes at him one time. It was very unintentional, but evidently, Sassy Megan rolled her eyes. I was a super senior at the time, and I didn't agree with. He asked me to play something different in a different way musically, and I guess young man didn't agree with what he suggested, and I guess I rolled my eyes. I didn't know that I did that, and he kicked me out of the room. He said that I, you know, disrespected his you know, musicianship or whatever. But I remember, I don't know. I mean, he just treated me like a daughter. So that was very impactful, and I would like to think that now with all my students that I teach, where I teach, that I mean a lot of what I do with them and guiding them and teaching them, because I have my own studio now, so I instill that into them, and it goes on.
Dean Witten, my student, my colleague, my friend, he left us way too soon. But what he left us with is something we should all cherish. His ability to understand, to communicate, to teach, to be a professional. He won't be missed, but never forgotten. My tribute to Dean.
Same time, Sage and Samira, Samara. Rowan will resume in 10 minutes. Thank you.
I'm I'm Helen Stewart, the Associate Dean of the College of Performing Arts. And it was my great good fortune to know Dean for the last 35 years. He was a mentor, a collaborator, and a friend. We made a lot of work together that cut across the disciplines of dance, theater, and music. And those works were performed here at Rowan and on professional stages in Philadelphia and New York City. And what I learned about Dean during that time is that he had an insatiable, voracious appetite for all things new. He loved the idea of his studio being a hotbed for creative activity, research, and scholarship and percussion. Therefore, he commissioned over 50 works, some that were performed and others that were premiered right here on this stage. And the pinnacle of his legacy came in 2012, when he invited the Grammy Award-winning and Pulitzer Prize-winning composer Jennifer Higdon to make a work on the ensemble. He partnered with the late Don Farish, our former president, and his wife Maya, who identified an anonymous donor who was in love with the percussion ensemble and this idea of creativity and was willing to come forward and fund this very special work. It will stand as a beacon for creativity at Rowan University because this work will stand in the annals of music history forever. So with my great pleasure, I introduce Like Clockwork. Please, as you listen to the work, enjoy it orally, visually, and viscerally, and really get a sense of Dean's passion and his legacy. We also very much want all of you to join us after the concert is over for a reception in room 153. I hope to see you then. Thank you.
So I have another honored guest to bring out. I would like to say something about my father. This is another one of these people that I've grown up my entire life learning about the history and everything that they do with the Philadelphia Orchestra. He just retired after, I want to say, 45 years? 46 years, excuse me. Who's down? Which is a really long time to play in one of the world's best bands. And this man is a really great friend of my father's. He's taught the students numerous times. He's been a guest artist here, sometimes twice a semester for years now. And another man that I've just grown up revering. And it's a great privilege to have him here and play in the Downfall of Paris with him. And so here comes Tony Orlando.
Wouldn't Dean have loved this? Thanks to Matt, with the support of the administration from Rowan, the staff, the students, the faculty, and all his friends. He's doing an incredible job. Wasn't that a wonderful piece? I had the good fortune to be here when Dean was rehearsing for that premiere of the piece, which I believe commemorated the 100th performance of his conducting the ensemble. So what a wonderful tribute. I'd like to talk a little bit about who Dean was and will always remain for me, and I hope for all of us here. He was a guy who, through his extraordinary work with work ethic, remains an inspiration to all of us. Imagine that, passing on and still remaining an inspiration. He was someone who remains a friend despite his physical absence. He was a man who shared with me the opportunity to join him in educating his students. He was a reminder that those of us who experience simpatico, or kinship with someone, you know that feeling we have of, even though it's been years or possibly months or beyond, you haven't seen that person, but when you get together, it was like you just saw them yesterday. And although I only shared with Dean a small portion of his life, you know, we met 4 or 5 times a year, or we communicated a lot through emails and texts, I believe we shared that simpatico. I know I felt that way. He remains an inspiration by his positive and clear-minded dealing with his own illness, as well as his friends. Steve Weiss especially comes to mind. He was a template on how to communicate and connect with those he taught. In our mind's eye, we can still see his swaggering presence while addressing audiences before and during concerts, and riffing calmly while instruments were being moved very quickly behind him. Dean was the man. The man we celebrate today for his lifetime achievements at Rowan and elsewhere, mentoring students, performing solo or with colleagues, rehearsing and leading the ensemble, and inviting others to present their own clinics and performances. Dean is still an example to us all. He showed us a way to live with a big heart, a way to be a caring soul. We love you, Dean. I hope I haven't devolved into jive. Anyway. I believe we're almost set for the next performance with the marimba orchestra, the wonderful marimba orchestra that Matt has put together. And that Dan Armstrong will shortly come out to lead. So, without further ado, Dan Armstrong, head of the percussion department at the University of Penn State University, and the Memorial Dean Witten Memorial Marimba Orchestra. Thank you.
tell you a little bit about the Muscle Room Orchestra tradition. And I think you did a marvelous job. If you've read the program in setting this up, the idea for an orchestra of marimbas has been around only 80 some odd years. The pictures in the program show the Century of Progress Marimba Orchestra, 100 specially built instruments, and they played a concert, at least one, probably more, at the Chicago exhibition, the Century of Progress World's Fair in 1933. And I also think that Matthew mentioned that his instrument, Fang, is in the picture that you see in your program. This instrument belonged to Dean's and my teacher, James Dotson, who was principal percussionist at the San Antonio Symphony. And it was willed to Matthew by Jim. 2 years after the 1933 orchestra, there was another even more famous group put together called the International Marimba Symphony Orchestra. The IMSO was made up of 50 men and 50 women, and they rehearsed over here in various groups in various places, got together and rehearsed at the Greenbrier in Virginia, and took off for a European tour of all things. And they were supposed to play for the celebration of the coronation of King George. The instruments for that group were made with resonators in this kind of position, representing the crown of the king. Unfortunately, when they got all the way over to England with 100 marimbas, 100 marimbists, and 200 marimba cases, there was a labor dispute and they wouldn't let them get off the boat. So they hooked up some gigs in Paris and Belgium, and finally, when they returned here, played their final concert in Carnegie Hall. I'm not sure if the Largo was on the Century of Progress groups played, but it certainly was one of the pieces that was done with the King George Orchestra. And some years ago, Dean asked me if I would put together a marimba orchestra for a convention in Philadelphia in 1990. And so I managed to find some original parts to some of the repertoire that they had played and do a little editing and correcting, and that's how we ended up with what we're doing here. So I'm going to conduct Largo, and then Dr. Salvatore Scarpa is going to come in and conduct Finlandia and Barbara Adagio for string.
just have so much to celebrate such an important man. And if you can bear with me, I've got a bunch of thank yous to go through, and then we'll lead you to our last piece, Amaze with Grace by Thomas Alper. I want to first thank you all so much for coming. No concert feels the same as one with such a great, loving audience. Today was overwhelmingly emotional. To know that your attendance isn't just supporting live music, it's generating funding for an excellent cause. To honor an extraordinary man who touched us all with his life, his love, his wisdom, and his music. And the warmth, love, support from my father all helped make today the special once-in-a-lifetime concert that it was. Thank all of you so much for that. The power of music to bring people together, to heal, to convalesce, is absolutely at the root of why I do what I do, make and teach music. And the fact that my father meant so much to all of you makes the pride for him unquantifiable. He was so proud of all of his students. And to be able to take the stage with his students, his colleagues, and his friends, some of whom were my students, who are my colleagues, and who are my friends, is the most significant and cherished moment of my life. This concert could not have happened without the help and support of a generous, extensive network of family here at Rowan University, our community. If you bear with me, I'm going to thank them all without the Academy Awards playing me off. I want to thank my family, Allison, Jose, and my mother, Susan, and my partner, Jason. The help that they give me is so important. Here in the music department, we would like to thank President Hushman and Provost Newell, who have been great supporters of the College of Fine Performing Arts, of my father and his endeavors, and of this wonderful concert. I'd like to thank Marie Polk and Megan Elizabeth Campbell in Advancement. Everyone in the College of Fine Performing Arts has been helpful. Our students, Dr. Rollins, our chair, the administrators, the music office, the dean's office, Dennis Daugherty in public relations, all the crew here at Flieger and their leaders, Kathy O'Leary and Dina Ford, Jeff Hyatt for recording and live streaming, Dave Semeta who handled all of the photo and video, the concert planning committee, which consists of Dr. Higgins, the director of bands, Maestro Sal Scarpa, who has been my teacher, who's now my friend and my colleague, Maestro, who I'm pretty sure I've worked under more than any other, Associate Dean, Dean Melody Stewart, who has been a major source of inspiration to me as far back as I can remember. And I want to thank Professor Douglas Mapp, a great longtime friend of my father's and mine, who helped immensely to produce so much of this concert. It's such an honor and privilege to be working here right now, where I grew up, with these teachers, these mentors, and role models. Some were my father's friends and are now my friends, some have been my friends for a long time. All of the All-Stars are some of the best students to come through my father's program. Eric Carr was one of my students. He's now in the Marine Drum Corps. I couldn't be prouder. I also have become close friends with great former students, Eric Marley, Gavin McCauley, Don Simpson, Ryan Cullen, Teresa Jerkovich. I remember when she was so shy, she was like almost afraid to play. And John Vines, and then Anthony DiBartolo, and Mika Godbole, and A.J. Lustig, who I performed in three other alumni events before this that are absolutely three of the most exciting musical experiences of my life. And I've done a number of my father's alumni events with us before with all of these folks, some of my most favorite musical experiences. Greg Dennis Scully was my karate teacher when I was about 10 years old. And has since then gone on to become this great teacher and marimbist and has helped me so much with advising here and there and helping me as a marimbist. And lastly, I'd like to thank someone who was what my father would have called a hero who saved the day at the last minute. One of the alumni All-Stars that was supposed to work with us had a family issue and wasn't able to do it anymore. And Glenn Dawson stepped in like an hour and was here and jumped right in as if he'd been there for the first two rehearsals. So thank you so much to him for doing that, for saving the day. And I want to thank all of you who participated, all of whom I consider my colleagues and call friends, and these All-Stars who I would play with anytime, anywhere, period. And I want to especially thank Dan Armstrong and Gordon Stout, two world-class artists, masters in our field that knew my father since before I was born, and have been mentors and champions of mine. Your presence humbles me. It's so great to have you here. And integral to this concert was Dean Rick Dammers, who said to me, "Let's do a concert in honor of your dad." And boy, did we do a concert in honor of him. So many of you helped us get to 3/5 of our goal for the endowment that we need for the scholarship in perpetuity. And lastly, we're here at Rowan in the College of Fine and Performing Arts and Music Department. My family and I want to thank the anonymous donor whose generosity that deeply moves us was solely responsible for funding the naming of the Witten Percussion Studio, which in kind fulfilled the largest portion of the scholarship goal. And normally I would feel uncomfortable saying this, but I think because we're all here, this special person, I think the cause is so great, I don't have any shame to ask. If you haven't donated, please donate. And if you find it in your hearts to help more, they're interested in your program, people all around here to collect your gifts, and you can always donate online at rowan.edu. Thank you, thank you, thank you. And to my father, Professor Dean Witten, your husband, your father, your friend, your colleague, and your teacher. Thank you. Supposed to speak, but there's nothing else to say.